Chapter 1. What's the problem? A few months ago, at a big family gathering, my older brother David asked me about my writing. As we squeezed around the long table of food taking up most of my parents' living room, scooping mashed potatoes and corn casserole onto our plates, he turned to me and said, "What's your writing about? What do you hope it will bring to the world?" He's a question asker, my brother. It can feel a bit like a job interview. Think on your feet, quick. There's no time for deliberation. The next question is already on its way. But he also offered this invitation to be seen that I both crave and shrink from, because I feel deeply connected to and also wildly different from my family. I wanted to hold up the honest truth of myself for him to witness. I also tensed my muscles in preparation of being benevolently misunderstood. I'm the youngest of 6 kids, each of us born about 2 years after the other. That's right, with the exception of your girl here, my family produces an abundance of offspring. Right before I was born, my parents moved from their low-income apartment complex, a 3-bedroom unit filled with themselves, their 5 children, and several rabbits, to a tall, early 20th century house painted a color my mom likes to call baby diarrhea yellow. Back in the day, the Taussigs existed on a plane all their own. They never locked their front door, and neighborhood kids traipsed in and out like it was an extension of their own homes. They didn't believe in wearing seatbelts or washing their hands before dinner. After all, if God wanted you to die in a car accident, no piddly seatbelt would make any difference, and exposure to germs made you hardier. They ran around delivering homemade baskets of flowers and candy to all of their neighbors on May Day, held their unwashed hands in prayer before dinner, and played outside without shoes. The cancer I was diagnosed with at 14 months old, the violent chemotherapy, radiation, and surgical treatments, and my eventual paralysis at age 3 didn't change any of this. For good or for bad, growing up in the Taussig family meant no wallowing, no time for grieving, and definitely no whining. When I became paralyzed, the baby diarrhea yellow house didn't undergo any accommodations. My parents didn't install ramps or handrails, and it was several years before I got my first wheelchair. I continued to sleep on the top bunk of the top floor of the house. I learned how to pull my body up the side of my bunk bed, my feet mere props as I used my arms to lift myself up higher and higher until I tumbled onto the top mattress. I crawled on hands and knees across the patchy grass and cement sidewalks to my neighbor's house, and when she wasn't home, I sat in the mud and made little bowls and cups with the clay. I started learning how to use a catheter to empty my bladder before I learned subtraction. My 3 brothers and 2 sisters lived this with me, sleeping in the bunk bed below or beside, squeezing my hands and squinting through the nightly prayer at the dinner table, all 8 of us piling into the 1976 5-passenger Ford LTD we called Hazel, making muddy magic potions together in the backyard. We lived our days climbing over each other like puppies in a box, side by side, wrestling to the ground, elbows smushed against rib cages. It didn't occur to us to talk about my differences, unless it was to play pranks on strangers in Walmart by leaving me and my wheelchair overturned on the ground, wailing and waiting for people to rush to my aid, which we definitely did. Although, in retrospect, I don't know why we thought this was so hilarious. Only much later did I realize how little we knew about ourselves, let alone each other. As close as bubbles in a glass of soda, and as far away as Pluto from Earth. During this window of crawling in the mud and scrambling up to my top bunk, I believed that I was royally beautiful, valuable, and fully capable of contributing to the group. Isn't that interesting? To feel the most regal during the days of mud and clamoring and scooting across the floor. I choreographed my own weird, passionate dances, wore frilly dress-up gowns around town, and pretended I was married to the prince. I felt talented and dreamed big. I floated in my own bubble, a universe where everything glistened and glowed, and I wore a crown sparkling with jewels. I believed everything I did, the way I moved my body, the way I looked, the roundabout paths I took, was right. I'd figured out how to do all the things I wanted, and I didn't see my methods as strange or sad. I knew that kids I didn't know stared at me, that adults directed giant sympathetic smiles toward me, that I prompted tears and applause, but I hadn't yet pieced together that I didn't fit. The fact that I couldn't walk like the kids in my class, that I wore a clunky mess of plastic, metal, and Velcro braces on my legs, used a battered aluminum walker, and sped around on my hot pink wheelchair, didn't really seem worth factoring into my evaluation of myself. At least, not at first.